Agriculture on the move.
Agricole en mouvement.
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 Good day again, viewers, and welcome to the program, Agriculture on the Move. I am Philip Sidney, your host. As I've said before, we have had a series of programs leading to World Food Day, which is on the 16th of October. And you will hear quite a lot of what the ministry has been doing in terms of various programs as far as food production is concerned. Today with me is Mr. Manus Cherry, who is the manager of the Union Plant Propagation Station, and he's going to discuss with us what is happening at that plant propagation in terms of plants that are made available to farmers and, of course, to you, the general person who wants to plant plants in your backyard. Welcome to the program, Mr. Cherry.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sidney, and of course, thank you very much, viewers and the general public.
Great. Manus, since you took up this position as manager of the plant propagation station, I suppose you can tell St. Lucia what is meant by plant propagation.
Well, plant propagation is basically the different methods used, the different methods employed in order to produce more than one of that particular plant. And of course, there are the new methods, there are old methods, but all of them have the same concept and a final objective, which is similar, which is the production or mass production of plants.
And there, so there are various methods of plant propagation. You have budding, you have grafting, you have air layering, you know, and the list goes on. And I suppose you can even speak about tissue culture is a form of
Yes, method. To us it's new, however, it's an old technique, however, that it is new. It is new to us, yeah, here in St. Lucia, not just St. Lucia, but in the Caribbean,
all right,
in the region.
Okay. And of course, the various types of propagation, if you go to scientifically, you have the sexual and asexual. Of course, you have the sexual, which is by seed,
yes,
you know, and then you have the other one, which is vegetatively propagated, as we mentioned, by cuttings also. Yes. Yeah, so what is the mandate of the plant propagation station?
Well, as you know, the plant propagation is situated in an area that has a very rich history. You know, in the past, we could say, even in the 1920s, this was a very huge farm, and you had a lot of farming practices ongoing. When I say farming practices, I mean mixed practices. You had vegetable production, you had plant propagation production, you had livestock production, you had fisheries production.
Right.
And as a result of the potential that this area has, they have found it fit for plant propagation or the propagation division or agricultural stations to work under the crop development program of the Ministry of Agriculture. And the main activity is planting material production.
Oh, definitely. Yes. Just even before, I remember some years ago, many moons even before, when I got to know about the plant propagation station, it used to be called Cocoa Center. Because apparently during that time, the ministry was pushing a lot of cocoa production during that period, and they definitely had to multiply a number of plants for farmers. So the hub was Cocoa Center. And from there, I think they diversified into just what you just said a while ago.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes. So now what we do, we're one of the three revenue generating agencies under the Department of Agriculture, and we presently produce a lot of fruit trees or fruit plants and ornamentals of which we would be able to generate revenue from.
So what are the type of planting material or plants that you produce for the farmers and the farming community in general?
Well, we produce a wide variety of plants via the different methods we've mentioned and also tissue culture. Mm-hmm. Via the most conventional method, which is grafting, air layering, we produce guavas, we produce citrus, like the sweet oranges. We produce mangoes and the different varieties. For the ornamentals, which are the flowers used for the beautification of landscapes, that is hotels and so on, we have alamanders. Our heavy sellers, for example, ixoras, bougainvilleas, are all examples of the numerous and diverse and the diversified amount of crops or plants that we produce. Via tissue culture, we do some root crops. We presently have yams available. We have bananas, plantains, and a lot of pineapples. So it's a very wide range of both food and beautification crop plants.
Oh, great. Okay. The mandate mainly is to produce planting materials for the farmers. How do you prepare, say, on an annual basis? Do you come up with a quantum of plants that are readily available to the farmers? And of course, and the other percentage is going to be for the backyard, farming hobbyists and other landscapers.
Well, it's an effort, it's an initiative that has to be worked through with the Extension Advisory Division. They're the ones that will inform us as to how much lands are out there available, for example, 200 plus acres of lands, and we have to prepare our work program in tandem with them in order to produce the amount of plants that are required to grow on the hundreds of acres of crops annually.
But what I have realized, and farmers are, let's be real, farmers are, and also other persons who want to purchase plants, they have a problem in terms of availability of plants. And that seems to be a perennial problem. What are your challenges? I suspect there's numerous challenges that prevents the propagation station for in producing those the number of plants required for to the farmers out there.
Yes, of course, we have numerous challenges, and I would just like to mention the main one, which targets the primary material, which is the plant itself. We have problems getting material or the right quantities of material and at the right time for citrus, avocado, all the fruit tree crops. Also, we have issues getting explants, that is, these are plants that we would use to grow the plants via tissue culture. And one of the reasons is because of the inborn diseases that we have affecting those plants. Okay. And in the past, it was better because, as you know, the banana production has created a good landscape for agriculture. And so a lot of these citrus plants, for example, were planted intercropped with bananas.
Yes.
And these same plants were being fed by the residual fertilizers.
Fertilizing the bananas.
Yes.
And they get the, yes.
And then also the pest and disease control that was done. But now that is no more. And you find these trees are dying. That is the citrus trees.
They are on their own now.
Yes. So it's difficult for them to give you that quality and amount of budwood that you need. Okay. That's just for the citrus.
Okay. But in the past, I know for a fact some years ago, because like I said, I must tell the public that I was a cadet, a trainee up there. I was trained up there for a year and a half to 2 years. And I remember we had some citrus orchard at Union. In fact, the history would show that where the Lucilec power station is at Union, which is now dormant, that used to be the citrus orchard. And to the right of it, there was the mango orchard. In fact, to those persons, interestingly, that area, they used to call the place Kayaway Pond. In other words, when you shout, you'll hear a recording of it coming back to an echo, coming back. So it's called Kayaway Pond. But there was another orchard on the hillside of Union, which was where I think right now. The thing is, every housing are taking over. So those lands have went into housing on the hillside. Then, of course, Lucilec took that whole trunk at the bottom, and the other side, I think their garages and everything. So, Union, they have been taking a lot of agricultural lands for other uses.
Even presently.
Even presently.
Even presently, because I'm working on some negotiation with Crownland.
Hold that point, because it's very interesting. We do for our first break. You're watching Agriculture on the Move. We'll take our first break. Stay tuned. We'll be back soon.
I am life. I am home to millions. And I sustain millions more. My abundance brings prosperity, while my scarcity can be deadly. I cover much of the earth, and my influence extends far beyond. I have been around for longer than you can imagine. But my world is threatened. People need to take notice and do more to secure my future, because I am worth protecting. Your health relies on my health. Your life relies on mine. I am plants. I am life.
Welcome back to the program, Agriculture on the Move. I'm speaking with Mr. Manus Cherry, who is the manager of the plant propagation station at Union. And Manus, it's interesting because I don't know, from me, when I was a cadet, you find the Union Agricultural Station was a huge station with a lot of loads of lands. And slowly and quickly, lands are being taken for other use, okay? Like I told about Lucilec. Then I remember we had banana plots where we were doing experiments on your way to Grand Rivier on to your left. Dimpolet Lucy School was built there. Then on the hillside, we had an orchard across there of citrus of various varieties. That's where we were getting our cyan budwood from, all right? Then there was a housing scheme to get over. Okay, and the list goes on and on. And then Wasco took over our coffee orchard also right by the bridge, and you know, it's amazing. So agriculture, as far as I'm concerned, as far as some of the policymakers at the time, you know, the priorities were not agriculture. So I'm sure you're facing the same thing now.
Yes, even presently, because as you said, we had hectares of lands there, and one of the areas in the construction sector, I think, is the housing development that's taking up a lot. Even presently, we're doing some collaboration with Crownlands. Mm-hmm. And of course, it's been done in a very good way, in that they're asking us, how much lands do we want to continue to occupy near our germplasm? And we've written, of course, telling them that, look, give us, you know, the extra block and parcel, mm-hmm. so we can establish, you know, our germplasm, first of all. So we're presently facing these problems where more and more the construction sector is encroaching and on our lands.
Yeah, and I forgot to mention, very importantly, you know, where we had this long building, which was the Agriculture Cadet Quarters and lecture room and storeroom, that was broken down to give way to infrastructure. Then you had funding scheme on the other side. You know, that was taken over. We had our livestock section there, our piggery there, that was taken over. So, I mean, slowly and surely and very quickly too, they're taking over our land. So the question I'm asking is, okay, now where do you all get your sand material from?
Well, honestly, Mr. Sydney, you know, it could be a very, I mean, that's a very, how should I put it? A very good question. Mm-hmm. Because we all know that there isn't just one or two places where we can go and get hundreds or thousands of citrus plants. We can access hundreds and thousands of citrus plants so that we can harvest that budwood material from. So what we get it from the farmers. Okay. And we get some from our germplasms, which are struggling because of lack of resources. Mm-hmm. And you know, that is what we've been doing for many years. So what we would do, we would go around. We would, of course, make arrangements with the farmers. They would agree to give us a certain amount of budwood. Some would, you know, feel courageous to ask us for payments. However, we would do some bartering. Some would say, look, I'm going to offer you to take as much budwood you would prefer, and then you just provide plants. Me some plants, mm-hmm. in return as a form of bartering. Mm-hmm. So that is what we're doing, and we definitely cannot depend on that. We cannot depend on the generosity of farmers. We have to be able to have our own germplasm, well-maintained germplasm in place.
Manus, it is a sad situation. Really, really, really sad. Where now your government have now become a beggar, you know, going to farmers. And again, going to the farmers to that faces some challenges because of pests and diseases, you know, of those tree orchards out there.
Yes. Because the farmers themselves don't have the resources to maintain, care for the plants.
Yes, correct.
And they
yes.
offering you. So yes, yes. it's something that you have to look yes. at closely.
But okay, is there some way, because I'm sure there are extra lands at Union that are idle, and is there a possibility of establishing new germplasm banks at Union?
Definitely. There are at least two areas that's underdeveloped. Mm-hmm. One is an area that is close to our one of our germplasms, mm-hmm. which takes you behind this Weewood and Leewood Brewery building, mm-hmm. close to the Union Terrace housing development. And the other is on the other side where the Wasco establishment is. These two areas can be used, and we can source funding, for example, through ICA, CADI, and these other agricultural institutions, mm-hmm. to, for example, establish a screenhouse,
right.
where you would have your plants growing in there. They would be free from pests and diseases, that right. is clean plants, mm-hmm. whether it be citrus, avocado, mango, and then you'd be able to go there, take your birdwood with no problems, and eventually produce and distribute hundreds of thousands of clean plants out
yeah,
there.
Yeah.
So there is potential, however, the resources are required in order to undertake.
But is this something that you have put forward to the ministry to ensure that at least given the time frame for the establishment of the germplasm banks?
Well, yes. I'm presently in contact with ICA and the Research and Development Division because there is some feedback that came back from some workshop from the Citrus Association of Jamaica, and we're looking at ways of trying to revamp, you know, the citrus industry, at least that part.
Right.
And first of all, we are hoping to bring in clean material, that is clean, that is plants that are disease and virus free, mm-hmm. Into St. Lucia, and then eventually we can do cleaning of our own stock material,
okay.
to eventually depend less on the extra-regional organizations.
But tell me, the cost of producing, say, one mango plant or a citrus plant, okay? I know the government have been subsidizing the sale of plants to the farmers. It's at $4 a plant, all right? But tell us, what is the real cost of producing one plant?
The cost of producing one plant presently, Mr. Philip, is minimum $25
right.
per plant.
Good.
And you could see that it's heavily subsidized because farmers would show up with the distribution forms from the extension officers
mm-hmm.
and request and buy the plants.
Mm-hmm.
However, you know, the ministry can save a lot by reviewing that policy and increasing the price of the plants mm-hmm. by, let's say, $2
right.
or more.
Okay.
Because the truth is that these plants have been at a subsidized price of $4 for too long.
Yes, yes.
And then when you look at the cost of the materials, that
it's increasing.
Is increasing.
Mm-hmm.
The cost of producing is increasing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So definitely the price of the fruit plants in particular mm-hmm. has to be increased.
But hold that point, we're due for another break, right? You're watching Agriculture The Move. Don't go away. We'll be back soon.
After hurricane, sustaining life and health is most important. We should take heed. Do not drink from any stagnant ponds and pools or directly from drums and outside storage containers. If, however, no other choice is available and you must drink this water, use 8 drops of bleach in each gallon of clear water or boil your drinking water for about 10 minutes. Use food that require little to no cooking or refrigeration, such as salted biscuits and canned foods. Use preservation methods for keeping refrigerated food safe to eat by salting, curing, and drying. Discard all perishable foods that have been in the refrigerator for more than 2 hours. And remember, once in doubt, throw out. This is the hurricane season, and we should be prepared. A message brought to you by the Ministry of Agriculture, Fisheries, Physical Planning, Natural Resources, and Cooperatives.
Welcome back to the program, Agriculture on the Move. Manus, this is a very interesting and crucial point we're discussing as the question of the cost of production of those plants. And government is subsidizing the farmer plus the ornamental buyer, because the guy who wants to, after he has purchased, half an acre of land, and he wants to build his house, he wants to plant some plants in his backyard. He's getting that at what cost? $10. Okay, yes. And the cost of production is about $25. So he too is being heavily subsidized. So what? As far as I'm concerned, that service is a service that is provided to the public. Right, and I believe the more plants you have out there is better for country, all right, in terms of our food security. However, I don't believe that the union should be making a profit. I believe at least break even is fine. But are you all breaking even? Are you all in the red? I mean, I would tell us where you are now.
I don't think we are close to breaking even, Mr. Sydney, because the landscapers, first of all, the farmers, the landscapers and homeowners are the major buyers. These are the ones we produce for. Mm-hmm. And they are getting the plants at a very heavily subsidized price. That is all three categories of buyers, farmers, landscapers, homeowners. Mm-hmm. And I believe it has to be a policy change that needs to take place in order for us to get close to breaking even. Mm-hmm. So we can generate revenue and at least operate under such a great loss, because I think $20,000 to $30,000 of dollars can be generated. That is in addition if there is just policy change to increase the price of plants, let's say the fruit plants, instead of $4 to $6.
Okay, what are you doing now to really correct that problem that you have now, which is the plants that are available to the farmers? There is some disconnect as far as communication is concerned between the extension officer and the Union Plant Propagation Station. Because I've been hearing from farmers, the officers would give them a requisition, say for 30 plants, and when they get there, they can only be given 6 plants. I mean, so you can understand a farmer coming all the way from Grass in V4 and coming all the way to Union, and the officer who is his point of contact will tell him, look, he can get 30 plants from Union. How is this happening?
I must say presently this is happening, Mr. Sydney, because of COVID-19. COVID-19 is also a disaster.
I know. Everybody using COVID-19, but that was happening before COVID-19, eh?
Yes, but I can address the part that happened previously.
All right.
People who never grew plants before were coming to buy plants. Mm-hmm. And these were plants we had reserved for the farmers, to get it in the rainy season especially. Right. So we've had a problem. We have a problem because I think the extension division is trying to move ahead, but however, we need to correct some things in-house first.
Right.
For example, sometimes the farmers would be issued 10 plants per variety. Mm-hmm. And it's definitely a demand that we cannot meet because of what we have on the ground, because of the challenges we have on the ground. And there are basically, I'd like to mention, 3 reasons why they're not able to get the plants and in the quantity and the time that they would like. One of it is at the times that they would come for the distribution of these plants, that is during the dry season. Mm-hmm. For the fruit plants, especially citrus, we don't take a chance and provide the farmers with these plants because they depend on the rain-fed system.
Correct.
And the maintenance of these plants, the good agricultural practices that you have to apply is key. That's one of the reasons. The other reason is because of the method of negotiating with our suppliers. So we have suppliers of seeds, suppliers of birdwood, who sometimes don't want to wait on a monetary payment. Mm. So they would ask us to provide them with plants for the amount of seeds they provided, provide us with plants for the amount of birdwood I've given you.
Okay.
So that's another reason. And yes, so maybe later on, I'll mention.
So how soon you think that problem will be resolved, Manus? Because apparently that looks to be a perennial problem. I cannot see that being resolved with what you're telling me there.
I think the farmers need to be re-educated as to how they manage the crops. Mm-hmm. And more resources need to be pumped into the propagation division or agricultural stations in order to give us that leeway, in order to give us that boost to be able to supply the demand.
People coming to buy plants from you, especially new persons who, like I said, the home buyers, do you tell them exactly when they buy the plant, how to plant the plants and stuff like this?
We do, and it's interesting because it's something I wanted to make mention of. We do extension advisory work. Okay. We do some engineering work. We do some research and development work. For example, when the home owners, for example, come, those who live in the peri-urban communities especially, we give them technical advice as to how to treat, whether it be the fruit plants or the orchids and the ornamentals. We sometimes visit florists as to telling them the optimum conditions for establishing a shade house.
All right.
That's the research and development. That's the extension part.
And there's an extension part you all need to tell them, the distance to plant the plants, especially the homeowners.
Yes,
especially because they see the plant small, and they would plant it about 2 feet apart. You understand? And in about 2 years, 3 years, is a jungle they have at the back, okay? And the other thing too, which is most important, then you should also tell them, do not plant it close to the house and also to the septic tanks, because the root can buttress and it can break the septic tanks. And so all of these things I think we need to, because I did this instructional video, you know, and I got a lot of feedback from that, trust me. Yeah, and people, a lot of people did not know, they should not plant the plant in the bag. And there are people who are doing it as we speak, trust me, okay? So these are the things I think you all need to let the buyers know. So just before we end, I need you to tell me, sell Union Station, sell your plants to the farming public out there.
Well, we would like the general public to know, all the stakeholders to know that we have the best planting material to offer, whether it be for fruit plants, whether it be for ornamentals. We also have the technical capacity. We also have the technocrats right there on site to provide them with all the information they would require.
Okay. The Taiwanese are supposed to be in collaboration with you all. What is the Taiwanese assisting you?
Well, the Taiwanese is doing a very good job at the Union Orchard in particular, in that they are helping to maintain the fruit trees by pruning. So for example, we have the guava orchard in the same area that they are farming and doing the demonstration. It's basically a demonstration area. And they're helping us to prune these plants in time so that we're able to go and air layer them to eventually produce and supply the general public with guavas, for example. So they're doing a good job in this regard.
And of course, with tissue culture.
Yes, of course. As you know, this laboratory was handed over by the Taiwanese government, and they've handed down a lot of technology in this regard. So we are able to now go to the farmers, whether it be plantain or banana, get that material from them, come back into the lab and produce hundreds of thousands of plants from just one explant.
Good. Well, Hannes, we have come to the end of the program, you know. You see how short it was, eh?
Yes.
Well, I want to thank you for being here on the program, Hannes. I think it's a lot we need to tell the public out there, because apparently they're not aware of the challenges that you face up there. And I'm hoping that moving forward, you will be able to, you know, go over those hurdles and have enough plants when farmers come up there, and us home buyers and the landscapers to get plants, you know, and you're saying to raise the plants, right, a little more, so you can make, can generate a little more revenue. Thanks again for being here, and I wish you success.
You've
been watching Agriculture on the Move. We of course, heard about the discussion we had on the plant propagation station at Union and producing plants to the farming community in general, including homeowners, farmers, and landscapers. People, we need to plant plants. Remember, agriculture is our business, and you need to eat fresh, St. Lucia's best. As we move into World Food Day, remember those out there who are poor and they are hungry. Plant a tree on that day so that we can remember World Food Day. I'm Philip Sidney. Goodbye.
Agriculture on the move.
Agricola movement.
Agriculture on the move.
Agricola movement.
Agriculture on the move.
Agriculture
on the move.
Agriculture
on the move.
Agriculture
on the move.